Sir, your microphone is not on.
Yes. I'm sorry. It was muted. So, thank you, Niharika ji, for introducing. And I would like to thank Professor Rachana and Indu ji also for inviting me to interact with all of you. I can see that now around 224 colleagues, they are attached, and it's really a good number. And it shows that, and I can see some of the people I met recently in my another workshop. So they are here also. So yes, Dr. Jagdish Dwivedi is here, and maybe there are some more colleagues, because I can see around 25 in one screen, not many. So, but actually I'm happy with the theme which you have thought, and it's very pertinent to, you know, ponder over these questions. I was listening to Professor Viswas also now, and in fact, it was, I don't know whether he has left the session or not, but I was regional director of Indira Gandhi National Open University for around 20 years. And I started my directorship from Shillong in 1996. And I still consider Shillong as the best place in India. And so when I came back from there, and people used to, when they talked to me, that let's go somewhere. And I used to think, where to go? Why just you sit here? Means I was thinking that I'm still in Shillong. It's such a beautiful place. So, friends, it's, you know, this theme, as I said, that it is quite interesting. And I'm not able to recall the person who said that, but there is a very good quotation I am remembering, is that disaster gave me two things, a moment to react and a decision to overcome. And this is what is happening now with us. We are in such a, you know, situation where unique things are happening. I think on 11th of April, the kind of, to some extent on some of the points, I agree with Professor Vishwas, the way the things are happening. Actually, I should say that the way things are happening is not the way we are doing the things. If you see, since the lockdown has been announced, and we all, UGC asked us to go online, to teach online, to create our online content, this, that, and overnight, in one of my editorials, I coined the term locust wave. You know, when the crop is ready, and sometimes during April or March, the locust wave, overtakes all the crops, and it's like, so something is happening now, and a crop of online teachers, they say. But we forget that it is not the online teaching what is happening. It is the emergency remote teaching. So these are the emergency measures. And sometimes I wonder what will happen once this pandemic phase, slows down. Will the UGC, who are the MHRD, are they saying that teach online? What will happen to them? Will we go back to our own, the old usual traditional, faithful face-to-face teaching mode? Or are we going to stay? Because, nowadays people are thinking that, oh, this is such a good idea. We are teaching our students. So it means you are saving on travel, no travel cost. We are saving for example, in the workshop, we are saving on two time tea, the lunch. Nobody, we are eating our own lunch. We are drinking our own tea at our home. So it's a big savings. And one of our new friends, they posted their messages on the Facebook that I conducted a workshop for my coordinators online, and I found it very, effective. And I was joking with them, so that does it mean that once this lockdown is over, you won't travel, you won't go at all these places? Will you still continue using online medium? That is the problem. we are just narrowing ourselves in this period. And at the end of the day, the lesson learned is so simple. Means with online and offline connections, Marshall McLuhan once said that the world is a global village. And there is an author, Ian Lawrence. Long back, he presented a paper in Washington, D.C. That does the flap of a butterfly wings in Brazil set off a tornado in Texas. So, and you see this corona, it started with Wuhan. So we can say that a butterfly flapping in Asia can cause a hurricane all around the world. And currently the global education system is in the middle of this hurricane. These times where we all are witnessing developments verily are certain interesting and strange. But the hope is that lessons will have learned once things hopefully return to normal. Though there were early warnings to be prepared, some paid attention to, some didn't pay. And I don't know whether I should place ourselves in the early warning sensors or late arrivals, but whatever. The kind of ongoing interruptions in education, you know, this is a kind of a first kind of crisis. Although we had Spanish flu many years ago, but this crisis to occur on a global scale now, it is in the digital knowledge age. And definitely there will be socio-cultural, economic and political consequences in the wake of this crisis. In other words, the educational landscape will feel the rush of air from the butterfly flapping wings to the full extent so very soon. If you remember, following this outbreak in December last year, the WHO classified it as a global pandemic. And to slow down and prevent its spread, many countries followed strict protocols, such as complete lockdowns or regulations to facilitate social distancing, while a few countries, they preferred herd immunity, like efforts to stop the viral outbreak included, including us in India, working from home, providing flexible working hours, or closing many institutions where people could infect each other. And protocols to shut down buildings involved schools, universities, many other means, all kind of educational institutions. And this situation forced all levels of educational institutions to operate remotely as we are doing now, and to put emergency remote teaching into practice. Now, this is the confusing here when we are considering ERT as online teaching, which are completely different set of things. And it has been found, I mean, as we all know that around more than 1.5 billion learners from all ages, UNESCO gives these figures, globally, they are affected due to the closure down of the institutions. And the affected number of students, they equal to the around 90% of the world enrolled students. And thus the shutting down of these schools, it has widened. Already there was so much disparity, but this phenomenon, it has widened the learning inequalities, and it has hurt the vulnerable children and youth disproportionately. I remember there is a college in New Delhi. I was assisting them for their online courses, and once I talked to the student, I have put it on my blog also, in my editorial also. A student is asking her teacher that, ma'am, when this lockdown will be over, because we are tired of it and this online learning is so boring. Why it is becoming boring? Because, you know, it is very strange. I have a friend in Japan and he was telling me that what they have done. They have asked all the students there to identify a room in their home. And they have to take a photo of their surroundings and get it approved by their institution as well as by the ministry. and then they have to sit around their normal teaching hours in front of the camera there. And it is happening. I very recently saw a video made by someone on, there is this small children, the kid didn't come into the picture, only the mother was there. So mother, while preparing the food, remembers that what are the class timings of the kid. At that time, the kid has to be woken up, get ready, the camera to be set up, and then calling that, okay, the camera is setting, you come here and sit in front of camera, the teacher will teach you. After that, the mother, again, she sees that, okay, when is the next class, when is the next class? Oh, okay, now there is this half an hour gap, let me wash her hair, like that, you know. So it is not only a pressure on the students, it's pressure on the parents as well, because they have to cope up with all these kind of things. And somehow we have considered that everybody is at home in this lockdown, so it means they have more time. So means till 9 to up to 6 o'clock sending these things. But definitely there are, as you all know, that even UN says that education is the fundamental human right, and in adopting this model of learning never stops, different measures they have been taken and solutions produced immediately to sustain the education system. However, despite these measures and solutions being fueled by this digital divide, this doesn't change the fact that there are known and unpredicted consequences beyond the interruption of education. But then their question is that why are we suddenly waking up to go online? We have now seen that the education system in general is broken, unprepared, vulnerable to external threats. And not only education system, it looks like currently in this wake of pandemic, it looks like perhaps all kind of system, they are broken, unprepared and vulnerable to these kind of external threats. Something happens and we are forced to be contained somewhere. And as a response to this global educational crisis, the online emergency remote teaching has been put into practice globally, everywhere. However, we struggle to define that what are we desperately trying to accomplish through this. If you say online teaching, or particularly if we go it in its origin, the online distance education, it involves more than simply uploading the content material, which is being done rampantly by many. And rather, it is a learning process, as Professor Vishwas was also saying, that provides learners the responsibility, the flexibility, the choice. And it is a complex process that requires careful planning, designing, determination of aims to create an effective learning ecology. If we see it in terms of its appearance, we are currently engaged in online distance education. However, in essence, this is only a temporary solution. That's why I was thinking that I don't know what is going to be happen, say, in September, when the UGC says that, okay, we can have our examinations at that time. Or maybe even if we consider by the end of the year, in what will happen in the next year? What are we going to do there? And means how the things, this online distance education is one thing, and the remote emergency teaching is another thing. And this distinction is very important, because the degree to which we teachers believe in distance education these days will play a significant role in the post-COVID world. And in this regard, when we consider this online distance education, we should go beyond sharing simple tools, which is being done nowadays, simple tools, tips or tricks, and instead focus on learning context, the changing learning needs, and the availability and accessibility of tools. Another significant extent we have to highlight is how learners are involved in the process, the learning, the learner engagement, the involvement of them, whatever the tool or the platform we are using, how the learners are being involved into it. It's the pedagogy, whether are we following the theory of behaviorism or constructivism, how they are engaged into it. And let's think that what do we mean when we use the word remote and distance in educational context? There are some nuances of implementation in the remote teaching or distance education. It differs from the emergency remote teaching. The distance education, as we say, it is a distance where it has between the teacher and the learner. But that gap is bridged with certain teaching tools. And in this case, primarily, it is means the time and space factor, the dimension. It is bridged using some sort of books. We have some manuals with us, or here, because the teacher's presence is not direct. The book has to speak as like the teacher is speaking to them. And that's why the format of distance education materials or the online education materials is become different in nature. Here we call them either self-instructional material or self-learning materials, which assist them in the achievement of that. And there is a philosopher, Carl Menninger. He says that what the teacher is more important than what he teaches. And under these conditions, because we have the urgency to rush into emergency remote teaching, calling it online learning or assuming the online tools to be a form of online education, it should be done with caution. First, designing learning systems under the wrong assumptions and framing them around wrong definitions will make us vulnerable to errors along the way. That is going to happen because there is no clarity. We have just switched over. Initially, we were standing in the classroom. Now we are sitting in front of camera, but the practices remain the same, bombarding with that. And when things get settled and go back to normal, what people will remember will be bad examples from a time of such crisis. And the years of effort it has taken to prove the effectiveness of this mode, it can vanish all of a sudden. It is therefore, it is our responsibility, the educator's responsibility, to speak truthfully and to provide working solutions and to use the terms carefully and intentionally. Another flaw in these current practices is the huge investment and high trust placed in the technology enhanced learning processes. Means to save the day, they can be effective, no problem into it. But for long-term planning, we should consider and we should reconsider that what we are doing. And we have to approach with caution arguments made purely on technology-centric solutions. You know, in the dystopian Brave New World, which the Huxley coined in 1932, we set our hopes on technology, hoping that it will save education and cure all problems. Yet it is a delusion to which we are recurrently lured into and trapped there. We naively forget that technology is a tool and not an end. And the right approach should be not be learning from the technology, rather learning with technology. And if we do not learn from our mistakes, reality eventually will take its revenge. Now, if we see that, what should we do then now, and how can we keep learning in a safe learning ecology? You know, it may be time to leave behind our obsession with teaching, transmitting knowledge and giving lectures using cool and shiny education technology tools and those things. People are nowadays, everybody is going on the internet and organizing classes. Even nowadays those coaching centers, they have also started releasing their advertisements that online classes in mathematics and something. But I found some of the innovative examples also. Here in our locality, in the next building to us where we are staying, I see every day there is a teacher. It's around, I think, eight-story building here next to our premises. And I believe that he must be a teacher. He comes around, I think, 5 o'clock in the evening with a portable microphone. And all the, I mean, the students in this society may not be his students directly, but those who are in the schools or there, over microphone, he will speak the question and then ask them to carry out, and then he will explain. And all other with parents, they are standing. I have the photograph in my phone. Say if you have a group, WhatsApp group or something, I can pass it on to you. It's very interesting. I made a video also. And then, you know, he tries to explain to them. And I was thinking that, yes, look, the dedication of this person, he's trying to still maintain that tempo that we should not lose time in this way. So there, using things, it's not necessary that there should be all kind of shiny tools only they can help. Really, we can according to the situation, work. And in this time of crisis, where people really they are under trauma, stress, and psychological pressure, should we focus on teaching educational content, or should we focus on teaching how to share, collaborate, and support? We should remember, when things go back to normal, people will not remember educational content anymore, but they will remember how they felt, who cared for them, and how we supported them. So we have to remember that care is a basic characteristic of human life, and that all the people want to be cared for, leaving behind the notion that this is the some great online learning experiment and an opportunity to test pedagogy or the pedagogic centric approaches. We should try to amplify emotional presence in order to create a climate of empathy and care. And following that, we should focus on different types of presence. For example, what we call them as in teaching learning process as the teaching presence, cognitive presence, and social presence. Similarly, you know, while we rush to implement emergency remote teaching, are we focusing enough on learners and learning? And that is still a basic question arises. And particularly, we believe that since we, I am into this field of online learning for a quite long time now, I have seen that in educational institutions, our focus is more on learners rather than on learning. So what happens that we try to create good, all those, again, I will say, instead of now shiny tools or cool education technology tools, we try to make things better. Oh, okay, my institution, it will have a very beautiful lounge in it, the reception area, the students come there and get impressed like that. Do we ever pay attention to that, whether learning is happening or not, instead of just trying? Because I remember that in our university also, sometimes we were used, it means when I was in IGNU, we were told that the learner is prime, so we should take care of learner. I think instead of taking care of learner, we should also be paying attention to learning, because the learner can be satisfied in any way. We all say good things to the learners, praise them, okay, make them good environment, give them sofa to sit, have air conditioned put into it, and that is happening in many of the schools, particularly like in Dwarka, where we live. We have seen many schools, all with the word international fixed somewhere into it, have some air conditioned rooms, and the school becomes international. And so whether the policies or the practices are there up to that level, we are not bothered about those things. So the focus, in addition to on the learner, on the learning also, because that is the ultimate goal. A learner will come, do something, go away. But if there is no learning, then what they will do when they go away? The learners nowadays, they are being simply bombarded with lectures, which I term the like locust wave. While we sit in front of a webcam, and it seems that the hitherto the focus on learner engagement is now but an afterthought. And based on these arguments, it is more important to build sport communities and share the knowledge and experience we have to provide efficient and meaningful learning process. These learning processes, of course, should not aim on purely learning, but rather be directed towards therapy, empathy, and care for that. And we should show our commitment to support our students and to the institute teaching and learning on grounds of pedagogy of care and not purely on didactic or insensitive grounds. But there is a problem. Unfortunately, there is no magic spell to make things right. And it is a well-known fact that means what we are doing is that one size fits all. That is being done. That's why we are doing it nowadays. We're thinking that everybody, one of my friends, they said that we wanted to conduct examination of students. We told them that everybody will come online. That the problem was with the students that they say that I don't have laptop with me. I work only with my mobile phone. I get my this data package of 1.5 GB per day. And that if I attend one webinar, one online class of 1 hour, that package goes away. What to do after that? Means these things there. And they don't work. And these kind of things, they don't work anymore. And before putting any approach into practice, we have to think about many variables, like our target group, their age range, technological infrastructure, their sociological or economic context. We have seen the examples from developed countries. They are at advantage in initiating emergency remote teaching because the infrastructure was better with them. But this is not valid for all the countries, and particularly if we see our situation, because there is a disparity into it. Some are better placed. Like if I say that I am in Delhi, I have Airtel broadband with me, so I'm connected. But what about someone who is in, say, for example, just if I say Varanasi or somewhere, because our students, they reported to us that, sir, how can I participate? Because I don't get receive signal here, because due to this lockdown, I am in my village and there is problem with me. So then we try to find out that what alternatives can be given to them. So, and as learning happens during these times, you know, it can lead to awful experiences for many. And in that case, some of the approaches which we have found on working it, like the open educational practices, the open resources or open data, open science, etc., they have been found to be quite, like I remember that many of the publishing houses during these times, including software companies, they tried to extend their support to us that, okay, for a few months, say for 3 months, etc., we are making our databases available to you. So you can access our database, our research, those things. So these things, they are being done, but the digital divide, it is still a threat. And many still suffer from the unavailable educational opportunities, not equally accessible to everyone. And this clearly implies that widening of the participation and the promotion of social justice and equity, they are really important issues, which should be still on our agenda. We can accept the excuses and even mistakes can be tolerated for the first wave of interruption to education. But what about the second or third or fourth wave? Next time what will come? We had some experiences of lockdown 1.0. Means we were just thinking that, okay, if we do this thing, things will be improving. But then we entered into the phase of lockdown 2.0. Then I think just now, tomorrow, this 3.0 is going to be over. And we will see that what happens in lockdown 4.0 and what happens there. So means if we can think of the first wave, but what about the future waves which will be very soon coming to us? Emergency remote teaching is not an option, but it is an obligation. If we persist in making excuses and mistakes now, what we will say to the next generations in future? Therefore, we need to prepare in advance, learn from our mistakes, and when the time comes, we would like to say that we did the right things at that time for the next generations, and we should be better prepared and re-engineering our educational practices through offline or online modes to respond to any kind of interruptions to education. Now, the world is changing very fast. There are many things happening. I was listening to Professor Biswas about the technology. Perhaps I think if you have heard about something, Sanjay ji, perhaps your screen is coming up there. If you can stop sharing, have you heard the name of Mr. Pranav Mistry, PRANAVMISTRY? He is supposed to be one of the very youngest professor at MIT, perhaps, and of computer science. And he is much more famous for his experiment on sixth sense technology. And in sixth sense technology, what he did at that time, that having sensors on the fingers, and if I have to take a photograph, I don't need my camera or my phone. I'll simply, with the help of sensors, will click it like this, and the photograph will be taken like that, those things. And that was very popular. Means you make a Google search on sixth sense, and you will find that video over the internet. It is still available there. And very recently, I think in association with working with Sony, he has created some humanoids. I think 6 or 7 models, prototypes, they are already in the market, because I think last year in some computer expo, a demonstration was given by them. And the onslaught of artificial intelligence, it is right here. Our television has AI applications in it. Our refrigerator has artificial intelligence applications in it. Our car works on, our vehicles works on those problems, on those algorithms. Everything has been taken over by that. And he was demonstrating that. And you may be knowing the famous case of Sophie, the first robot which has been granted citizenship. I don't know which country, by some country, I forgot the name. They have given that the citizenship also for that. And means we normally discuss about the role of teacher and that the teachers cannot be replaced. I am not sure about that statement anymore. If the things keep on continuing like that, maybe things will be very strange, because the machines are coming up. And those Arnold Schwarzenegger kind of Terminator things, they are happening slowly. And suddenly one day, like Corona attacked us, you never know, those machines, they will something like that here. So the world is changing, and the cause of interruptions to education, they are not limited only to these pandemics or the wars or the local conflicts or some sort of natural disaster. Here the practice which we are doing, the remote teaching or emergency remote teaching or providing solutions, it has to be on a broader scale. And as a matter of fact, what we teach to our students in these times, they can have a secondary importance. First of all, we need to keep in mind that students will remember not the educational content delivered, we don't remember, but how they were engaged during this time. I remember that there was one interview being conducted. There is this candidate appearing for the interview, and the interview board is there. And one question was asked, candidate couldn't reply. Second question was asked, couldn't reply. Third question was asked, couldn't reply. And the board was saying that, your degrees, they show that, you have a good academic record, but now you are not able to reply any question. So one of the member in the board commented jokingly that, you know, at that time when this examination was conducted, and now after some time, the people, they don't remember. So perhaps like we have expiry date on our products. You know, if you purchase something, water bottle, there is some expiry date on it. Maybe we should do the same thing with our educational degrees also, that the result of this candidate is valid as on this date. The attainment is certified as on this date, but after this date, we don't know. Like, because, you know, these things. So content, we see ourselves, whatever we studied in our MSc, in our, say, or for example, for PhD, which is supposed to be the highest degree, the development of intel of the highest order. But how much do we remember? What we have inculcated over a period of time from our experience, that makes it, so we need to wait for how our learners, they will be narrating these experiences and the kind of transitions in which we are going through. So I believe that these are the exciting times for us as teachers, for our students, and in fact, those the technology solution providers also, which are on our doorstep, trying to lure us that my product is better and this software can do these things and like those. So, but these are the challenges which I thought that I can share with you. Okay, so any questions? We can have. Sorry.
Thank you, sir. You can have a glass of water.
I know, but it's
we okay. Cannot.
Okay.
Yeah. Jay. Thank you, sir. Many questions are there. Someone has asked that teachers are digital immigrants, whereas the students nowadays are digital natives. So how to fill the gap? And ये हम लोग भी महसूस करते हैं सर कि मेनी ऑफ अस आर डिजिटल इमिग्रेंट्स तो हमारे लिए चैलेंजेस ज़्यादा हैं कि हम अभी तक तो हम इसी पर थे कि हम वी वर स्लोली अडॉप्टिंग द वेब सर्फिंग एग्जामिनेशन मेथड्स ऑनलाइन मार्क्स चढ़ाना है वो सारा कुछ और इमीडिएटली कोविड 19 ने हमें ऐसी जगह ढकेल दिया जहाँ हमें सब ई लर्निंग का ही वो करना है तो व्हाट हाउ टू फिल द गैप मेनी ऑफ द रिस्पोंडेंट्स आर पार्टिसिपेंट्स आर आस्किंग सर कैन यू
नो आई एग्री विद दिस दिस इज अ वेरी वैलिड क्वेश्चन एंड वेरी गुड क्वेश्चन आई एग्री विद इट एंड आई आल्सो रियलाइज इट बट यू नो इफ यू सी इवन इफ दे से दैट द यंगर जनरेशन इज डिजिटली नेटिव इन व्हाट दे आर डिजिटली नेटिव And just see in what Instagram, Facebook, sharing their information in like that only. So it means in terms of education, teaching, learning, we both are at par. Means the kind of, dimag se paidal we are. So it doesn't make a big difference among both these groups.
Students are Google generation.
Yeah, they are Google generation because they can type faster on their mobile phone using it. And we are still one finger keyboard typing machine. If we need to type, we do it. Okay. THEY, they, like that. No. But they you are very right. Means joke apart. This is a very serious issue. And what I believe that we need to try to learn that how actually ultimately how we can create this the learning environment using these teaching tools. They are the teaching tools, and that's why many of the universities nowadays they are having these faculty development programs in which we try to discuss. But unfortunately, what is happening, what I have noted is that the more focus is on tools. And the tools may change. I don't know how many of you remember that once upon a time. I remember it because long back, maybe around 30 years ago, I was the expert in that in my whole state. And people used to call me on phone. Ke sir, wo word star mein ये कैसे करना है. एट दैट टाइम देर वॉज नो एम एस वर्ड, इट वॉज ओनली वर्ड स्टार. वेन इट वॉज देयर डॉस, एम एस डॉस, देर वॉज नो विंडोज एट दैट टाइम. सो over a day sudden you learn a tool, but that you learn a programming language and that programming language goes away, replaced by something new, and then what do we do? So we should not, we although we try to learn a tool, but we should pay more focus on the mechanism behind it also. So for example, just let me take this example of Zoom. Everybody is criticizing it nowadays, including the government. But believe you me, there was no fault of Zoom into that. अभी आजकल मैं आपको बताऊं क्या हो रहा है, वो Facebook पे मैं देख रहा हूं लोगों को, पता नहीं है किसने चैलेंज चलाया है, कभी तो वो आइस बकेट चैलेंज चलता है, कभी जंपिंग का चैलेंज चलता है. आजकल एक चल रहा है कि आप अपने बचपन की फोटो और अपनी आज की फोटो को इकट्ठा करके डालिए. अरे यार, आप खुद अपनी फोटो जब Facebook को दे रहे हो तो फिर आप क्यों किसी को ब्लेम करते हो कि मेरा डाटा चुरा लिया. वो तो चुरा कहाँ रहा है, आप उसको दे रहे हो. मैं किसने आपको बोला है कि आप अपनी दोनों तरह की फोटो रखिए. फिर कहेंगे कि नहीं, मेरी आइडेंटिटी थेफ्ट हो गई, कोई मेरा प्रोफाइल बना के फिर उसको यूज कर रहा है. वो करेगा क्यों नहीं, खुद ही फोटो दे दी तो वो तो उसको तो, ये तो वो बात है ना कि वो आप सोने की तिजोरी खोल के बैठे हैं, सोच रहे हैं नहीं रामराज है, रामराज तो चला गया, अभी तो कलयुग है. दैट वे सो दीज थिंग्स दे मेक दिस वेरी यू नो. We need to learn that how the cyber world and the cyber practices they work, so that we can use these things for betterment of learning with our students. This is a phase, but it is not only the phase that these technologies are being used now. Zoom ki thi. If you know how to use Zoom, definitely I can assure you that next day if you have to use WebEx, you can use it without any trouble. Because the interface is same. Next day, if you have to use Google Meet like we are using it, definitely you can use it. So here the focus was not on learning a tool. Here the focus was on learning that how you have to use a particular thing. What is the mechanism behind it? How do we connect it? And that, so that is more important. If we are clear of that, this technology will never scare us. And then in that case, we will be at par with our younger generation, who I also believe that they are much faster with us in grabbing the technology, because they see all these kind of screens with us. They are more comfortable in handling the technology, the options menu in something. If you have a microwave, the digital microwave, in which there are so many options, we try to find out. But how quickly we can pick up those things is very important.
Yeah, definitely we have to use the technology with very cautious and things. One more question is there. Dr. Naranjana Srivastav has asked that new education recommendations are also proposing to change the curriculum and methodology adopted. Do you see any logic in taking this crisis time as a break from all the toxicities, including old patterns of learning, and recommend a self-learning and observation method for this period instead of classroom teaching, online or offline, whether it may be?
Definitely. Actually, we have been talking about curriculum for a long time and making these changes. But unfortunately, you know, the development in other areas is at a much faster pace than the changes in education. And that brings a gap. So definitely we, and particularly there are, I know that there are some universities and in some countries, they keep on revising. And in that case, this field of e-learning, it is a better alternative to that. Because in our traditional system, it takes a lot of time in changing the curriculum and then putting it into the force and then delivering it. But if through the online medium, it becomes easy. You have your content once ready. The program is ready with you. And as soon as anything changes, you just modify it, revise it, and then the delivery mechanisms, they are already in place. So yes, I agree that this is the right time. Perhaps we can think over it and ponder over that. And it is a good time for that.
So one last question. Migrating towards online learning emerged as an organic option for all. So do we need blended learning system or education system post COVID-19, whether that will include offline, online, all kind of systems? So do we need any blended education system?
Yes. And in fact, I think around now we have around 1,000 universities with us, and so many around 40 to 50,000 colleges and various other institutions. Perhaps I think up to the 70% of us still are in some sort of a blended learning environment. Means if we are using WhatsApp group even for our students, we are already using that.
Yeah.
And it is a good idea that we use this, we retain it, because it is easier for us now. We don't, you know, it is a very easy medium for us for communication, for collaboration, for constructivism, to approach, to be in touch with our students. So I agree with that. Yes, we need to retain it. We need to rather promote it and try to see that wherever the student involvement is there and wherever there is a need, the teacher presence, the teaching presence, the social presence, it is definitely required and it should be there. But wherever for those other things, you know, I have seen many teachers who go to the class, teach that content, which can be delivered through online modes also, and then students can access them offline. Definitely for that, there is no need for you to consume your energy. It is better that we involve our time, we invest our time in those kind of activities where some of the resources we can provide them, that they can. And that's why this flipped classroom approach, it has become quite popular. And in industry, in corporate world, they do it very regularly. Because many things, and Google is doing what? Google is considered as to be the biggest university or the biggest teacher in the world. And perhaps I think in the previous session, some mention was coming of YouTube. Means whatever the thoughts there at that time, but believe you me, the YouTube has become a very great resource for many of us to learn things. I know that there are many students also who have learned programming languages by just watching YouTube videos. There was no teacher available to them, but just watching, because there are many, many resources available for the people. So if we have that kind of resource and if the students can learn, I still remember that there was in this Times of India, I think just last year or last 2 years, I saw a very interesting cartoon into it. You may be knowing Ajit Nainan, the most famous cartoonist. He may makes so many those illustrations into it. So there is this school building and a small boy, the mother is dragging the child towards the school. The child is not going, and the caption below the that cartoon is written that, "Mama, why do I have to go to the school when Google can teach me anything?" And in the classroom nowadays, when many institutions I know, they have put Alexa and other teaching assistants where, and it's a good thing because the teachers, they themselves use also. We do not know everything in ourselves. If I say that I teach computer science, I may not be knowing everything. I may be knowing something, but these things, they complement me. And that's why having them into our teaching learning process there, it's definitely helpful for us. But they are our assistants. They are for us. We are not for them.
And one last question from my side.
You please go ahead with your question. Continue. I remember what I have to say. I'll add that. Yes.
No, you can continue that. I'll ask after that.
Okay. I was saying that we are now in the age of artificial intelligence, and these technologies, they are going to change many, many things. I think China was the first country to introduce AI in its course from the primary level. And it is a good thing that in India, CBSE, they first came up with class 8th curriculum on AI, and then later on made it a 5-year program, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So from 8th class 12th, we have now the curriculum for artificial intelligence. Because if we do not prepare our students now, after 10 years, after 5 years, this situation is going to be problematic. But the question is, where are the teachers? if you see current situation in universities or in computer science institutions, this artificial intelligence at most of the places, it comes into MCA, and that too as an optional subject, which everybody will not take. So then there is a dearth of teachers on this course. And when it is, it is coming up, means if we believe it or not, means like our teacher, Professor M.M. Pant, maybe many of you know him. He gives a very interesting example that which approach we are into. Are we into ostrich mode or giraffe mode? The ostrich mode is when there is a sankat on us, we try to bury our neck into the sand and think that, oh, the storm will pass away. Or we try to be like a giraffe. In the giraffe approach, we try to rise up, try to see, assess our situation, and then act accordingly. So these things, when means ultimately, you know, who believed that one day we will be carrying our phone in our pocket? And nowadays it is not a phone. It's a chalta firta computer. Many people I know that they have, means aajkal kisi ke ghar mein shayad desktop computer to hoga hi nahi. Hoga bhi to kone mein rakha hoga. Mostly we use laptop. So the things are shrinking, the power is increasing. And that way many things they, these are the evident happenings or the changes which are there. Keeping in view all these things, unfortunately, our field, the education field, we are the last one to adopt these things. If any technology comes, either it will be the health sector or transport or communication, immediately they will take benefit of that. And we are the last one. I don't know why that means resentment is there into it. But ultimately, at one point of time, you know, if you see that Roger Bell curve, there are some leaders, and then there are followers, and then there are laggards. So those who are innovators, they are the first one to take the benefit of that. Initially, when the mobile phone came, they were considered as the item of luxury. Now they have become a necessity, because our we have become so much dependent on this device with us. Like that. Ji, aapka question.
मैं ये पूछ रही थी सर, बियॉन्ड द टीचिंग लर्निंग सिनेरियो, फॉर टीचर्स, हम लोगों के लिए ये बहुत डिफिकल्ट हो रहा है कि मेनी ऑफ अस आर कह रहे हैं ऐसा कि पहले टाइम स्लॉट था कि 5 घंटे की नौकरी है, अभी जो ये सिचुएशन आ गई तो अब कोई टाइम नहीं रहा. एंड आई वॉज टॉकिंग टू माई वन ऑफ माई टीचर, एंड शी वॉज सेइंग कि 18 घंटे तक भी कॉलेज में रहते हैं, उसके बाद घर जाते हैं, ऑनलाइन टीचिंग मटेरियल तैयार करते हैं, उसके बाद ऑनलाइन क्लासेस लेते हैं, मतलब देयर इज नो टाइम बाउंड्रीज. तो फॉर टीचिंग फ्रेटर्निटी तो ये मुश्किल हो रहा है, पर स्टूडेंट्स मे बी इट विल बी इजियर, क्योंकि बहुत सारे लोग जो हैं वो ये क्वेश्चन कर रहे हैं कि बहुत टाइम टेकिंग है ये सारा कुछ. और तो व्हाट वी लाइक टू कमेंट ऑन दैट?
नो कमेंट. आपने वास्तविकता ध्यान की है, वास्तव में ऐसे हो रहा है. मैं आपको बता रहा हूँ कि अभी यहाँ पर कुछ कॉलेजेस हैं दिल्ली के, जिनमें जिनको मैं हेल्प कर रहा हूँ, उनके जब स्टूडेंट से बात होती है, देखते हैं कि लिटरली वो सवेरे से उनकी क्लास शुरू होती है. और इसीलिए वो जो मैं आपको वीडियो भी बता रहा था कि वो जिसमें मदर ही सारा काम करके दे रही है बच्चे के लिए, मीन्स दिस सिचुएशन इज व्हाट वी हैव थॉट दैट सडनली without realizing how to use this media, we just adopted it. और हमें लगा कि नहीं ठीक है, ये जो मेरी लैपटॉप है, मेरे सामने जो मेरा वेबकैम लगा हुआ, मेरा जो इंटरनेट है, ये मेरी क्लास हो गई. और इसके अंदर आप जो 25 लोगों को मैं एक साथ देख रहा हूँ, मैं अभी देख रहा था शेर सिंह जी मेरे कुलीग हैं इग्नू के, वो भी मुझे स्क्रीन पे दिख रहे थे. तो वो ये मेरी स्टूडेंट, बस हो जाओ शुरू आप. एंड getting very little time. Abhi mera khayal hai wo kaun si company, I think it is an advertisement for Zoom. Aap kabhi unki us par website par dekhiyega. Wo kya dikhate hain ki pehle to teacher baitha hua hai laptop ke samne, wo kar raha hai, fir camera thoda sa pan out hota hai to pata chalta hai ki wo jo student hai, lady jo baithi hai, wo ek haath face to uska hai but dusre haath se wo aata gund rahi hai. फिर ऐसे दूसरा सिचुएशन होता है, वो उसके अंदर वो दिखाता है कि बैठा तो सामने है, मीन्स फॉर, ये देखिए ना, ये बड़ी इंटरेस्टिंग चीज है और हम सभी इसको करते भी हैं। ऑनलाइन टीचिंग के बारे में ये बोला जाता है कि वी शुड बी डिसेंट वेस्ट अप, बिकॉज कैमरा हमें केवल इतना ही देख रहा है, सो वी शुड बी डिसेंट वेस्ट अप, सो नोबडी नोज दैट व्हाट इज हैपनिंग ऑन द साइड, व्हाट इज हैपनिंग इन द साइड प्लेस, सो बट द थिंग्स आर, मीन्स वी नीड टू चेक दैट वी शुड नॉट डू इट इन एक्सेस, एंड दैट्स व्हाई आई नो दैट द रिएक्शन ऑफ द स्टूडेंट्स is they are not happy with this, and really they are waiting that when this lockdown will be over and we will be saved from this onslaught. मैंने इसीलिए locust wave अपने एक editorial के अंदर उसको लिखा है। ये तो एकदम से बस start हो गया और अभी आप खुद देखें कि कितना ज़्यादा, मतलब इसके लिए हो रहा है कि वो students के ऊपर pressure है। और ये इसमें एक चीज़ ये होती है कि मान लीजिए student को हमने यदि एक घंटे पढ़ाना है तो online teaching के अंदर ऐसे टीचर भी हैं, फेस टू फेस आप खड़े होते हैं तो कई बार मैनेज हो जाता है, बट ऑनलाइन मीडियम के अंदर यदि आपके पास और आइडिया नहीं है, और थॉट नहीं है, और कुछ नहीं है, सिचुएशन कैन बी वेरी एम्बैरेसिंग, बिकॉज यू कैन नॉट डू, समहाउ वी हैव स्टार्टेड थिंकिंग दैट इट इज, वी हैव टू कंटिन्यूसली थिंक इन फेस टू फेस क्लासरूम, यू कैन हैव लिटिल रेस्ट, यू कैन डिस्कस समथिंग एल्स, बट हियर नहीं, आपको जो भी करना है करना है। एंड देन फॉर टीचर्स आल्सो, नॉट ओनली दी स्टूडेंट्स, आई बिलीव दैट वी आर आल्सो अंडर ए ट्रीमेंडस प्रेशर ड्यू टू दिस ईआरटी, इमरजेंसी रिमोट टीचिंग, मेनी मेनी ऑफ अस वर नॉट प्रिपेयर्ड। मैंने देखा है, मैं इतनी सारी वर्कशॉप कराई हैं, इवन अभी तक काफी सारे लोगों को इवन माउस को प्रॉपरली कैसे हैंडल किया जाए उसमें भी तकलीफ है, वो इसलिए क्योंकि उनको कभी अपॉर्चुनिटी नहीं मिली, they never thought that they may have to use it, and that is creating a problem for them.
Yeah.